I don't know. I think he's excited.
Maybe we ought to have him come sing it again. Y'all want to hear it again? Brian, don't go anywhere. Y'all want to hear him again? Okay. What'd you do with it? You got it? Okay. I'll sit down. I'm Hey, don't hold back. You know the song. Sing it with him.
You know it's singing with him. If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me back to where I started from, I know that you would see. Of love that took me in its sweet embrace and made me what I am today, a sinner saved by grace. I'm just a a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, he took my place. Now I live and breathe in freedom with each breath. I'm loved and forgiven, back with the living. I'm just a sinner saved by grace, saved by grace.
God's good to us, isn't he?
Amen.
I'm just a sinner saved by grace.
Amen.
That's right. Yep.
Just let them know we love them and let them know that God died for them too.
Yep.
Yes. He can take their sins away just like he did us.
Yep.
No matter what they've done. Right. I know what I've done. I don't know what you did in the past. But God will give it all.
That's right. Amen. This is a new side of Miss Marianne I haven't seen in a while. I love it. I love it. Yep. Yep. God has been doing some amazing things in Miss Marianne's life, and she just, I'm telling you what, there's a new excitement about her. And I love it. I love it. Thankful. He is so, so good to us. Yeah. All right now. All right. Yeah. I tell you what, what is that old saying? If your wood's wet, what? That'll even light your wet wood. I don't even know how it goes, but man, that was great singing, great song. Listen, all the singing this morning has been wonderful. The congregational singing, just everything. And I've really enjoyed it, and it's spoken to our hearts. And you know what? Music is powerful. Be careful. Guard yourself. Music is very, very powerful. Well, I'm glad you're here this morning. I'm glad that the Lord has brought you here. And, you know, we've been blessed already, but, you know, true blessing, honestly, comes from God's Word. That's where it comes from. That's where it sticks. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing, even dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and joints and marrow. I want you to understand, I praise the Lord for great music. We have a great amount of pianists, a great amount of people here, but I want to challenge you. The only thing that's going to change your life is the Word of God. And I want to change our lives this morning. Take your Bibles. Let's turn to Acts this morning. Acts chapter 17. If you would, when you find your place, let's stand for the reading of God's Word. Acts chapter 17. We're going to look at our theme verses again this year. Verses 26 and 27, respectively. Acts chapter 17, verses 26 and 27. Thankful for God working in your hearts this morning. He's real. He's real. Acts chapter 17, verse 26, the Bible says, "And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times... and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if happily they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far away, far from every one of us." Our theme this year is to seek the Lord. I mean, not just show up on Sunday and say, "I'm seeking the Lord," but every single day, our lives, our minds, our hearts, our intents ought to be, "Today, Lord, I want to seek you today. I want to seek you in my life today, Lord." That's my prayer. That's our goal. That ought to be our goal as a church, but it ought to be your goal individually. I love that. "That they may feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us." The Lord's here. He's not far. He's not far away. He's close. Father, this morning I want to ask you to touch your word, touch the verses that we're going to be reading this morning. Through your word, touch hearts. I believe the hearts are already prepared and they're open and they're ready, willing to hear from you. And I pray now that my words would only be your words, and your words would cut directly to our hearts. And we would leave challenged, convicted, and changed because of your word. Sure love you. Thank you for allowing us to be here this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This month we've been talking about seeking the Lord through our tithe. Our tithe. Now, when we talk about our tithe, remember the tithe, that word tithe, just simply means, listen, I know what happens as soon as I say that word, people buck up. I mean, it's like ears closed all of a sudden. I've just closed everybody's ears that were open a minute ago. That word tithe simply means a tenth part of anything. Okay? Last week and the week before we did talk about finances and what belongs to God and what the fact that we could be robbing God if we're not careful. This morning, I want to talk to you about tithing of your time. Your time. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9, he says, honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thine increase. That word substance, the Lord, it says, honor the Lord with thy substance. What makes us us? Everything about us. Everything that we have, everything that we hold dear to us. Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thine increase. Your time is fleeting. Time flies. Where did time go? And that, some of the questions we ask ourselves, or some of the things we say amidst conversation. Where have you been? It's been a long time since I've seen you. What's going on? You know, it's been a while. It's man, time flies when you're having fun, or when you're not having fun. Doesn't matter, right? Read the story of a very nervous airline passenger, and he began just pacing the terminal when bad weather delayed his flight. He looked outside, and during the walk, he came across a life insurance machine. I didn't know they had those. They had this little machine, and you can buy life insurance. So he saw it, and it offered $100,000 in the event of an untimely death aboard the flight. That's kind of bad to have in an airport, huh? But you make some good money. The policy was just $3. $3 so that if something happened on that flight, you'd receive $100,000 in benefits. He looked out the window at the threatening clouds and thought of his family at home. For that price, it was foolish not to buy. So he took out the coverage and then he looked for a place to eat. You know, airports now, they have just a broad range of places to eat. So he finally settled on one of his favorites, and it was Chinese food. He goes in there, and it was a relaxing meal until he opened his fortune cookie. The fortune cookie, it read, your recent investment will pay big dividends. Time. We all have the same amount of it as far as in a day. Each one of us are given the same amount of seconds, the same amount of minutes in a day that God gives us a full day. My question to you is, do you give God a tithe of your day? Do you give Him a tithe of your day? Now, I talked about the first fruits and somebody was talking with me, and we were talking about what is the beginning of the day. You remember that? Remember that conversation, Brother Steve? It was a great conversation. Read the Bible. And he took me back to Genesis, and he's just helping me out, and we're just talking. But if you go back to Genesis and the creation story, what does it say? The evening and the morning were the first day. You ever think about that? He started with the evening, and the morning were the first day. You ever thought about that? So what's a day? Anyways, that's just fun stuff. But my question today is, do you tithe the time that God gives you? Do you truly give the Lord His tithe of your day? He is the one that gave it to you, right? In our verses we read in Proverbs, it says, give Him the first fruits of all thine increase, right? And immediately our mind goes to money, financial. Immediately. We think money, okay? First fruits of all thine increase. Well, if the Lord has given you another day, is that not increase to your life? And God says to give the first fruits or the tithe, honor the Lord with the tithe of your day. I want to talk to us this morning about tithing our time. Tithing our time. As we think about this, I want you to understand our time is limited this morning. We have a limited amount of time. And some is shorter and some is longer than others. Our time. And God, only God knows our days. Only He knows the amount of time you and I have. From the moment we're born, we begin to die. You ever thought about that again? I mean, just many of you may have heard that before, but let's remind ourselves. From the moment we are born, we're beginning to die. We're not promised. Only God knows our days. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 3, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 3, he kind of basically writes down how many days of flesh, give or take. It's almost like he said the average of days will be 120 years. But in Psalms chapter 90, verse 10, it says, the days of our years are 70 years and 10. Can you tell me how many years that is? 70 years. Hey, Brother Don, how old are you? 30. He sure did. He's 71. Living on borrowed time. We're not promised tomorrow. I'm not promised today. But too many times in our minds, we're so focused on retirement and we're so focused on the end of our work days that we're not even, kind of like Miss Marianne, what you said, we overlook today. We overlook at what God has given to us to use today. He's not only given us money to use, He's given us time to use. And can I tell you, if you're not using God's time, it's not yours. He's the one that created it. He's the one that created you. And if you're not using your time for God, then can I tell you, you're robbing God? The psalmist in Psalm chapter 31 said this, my times are in thy hand. The psalmist recognized who his times belong to. Every day that God allows us to put our feet on the floor, or even just, you know, even if you're sick and you lay in the bed, every minute, every second that you're given is His time. It's His time. Only God knows our time. We don't. James chapter 4, verse 13, a very familiar passage. Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or do that. See, we don't know our time. We don't know we didn't know the beginning, and we definitely don't know the end. This is a reality of life. It's a reality of life that we see working in the hospital. It's a reality of life we see working for first aid, first responders. Life is short and be gone that quick. But I want you to understand your life. I just said that our time is limited, but our time is valuable. Valuable. Time is valuable. It's the most precious commodity that you and I have. Because it's something that once we spend it, we don't get it back. Let's pretend that you're today that your banker phoned you late last Friday, gave you a call. Now it's Sunday, it's a couple of days past, but and he says, I got some very good news for you. He told you that an anonymous donor who loves you very much has decided to deposit 86,400 pennies into your account each morning. Starting the following Monday morning, so tomorrow morning, someone's going to deposit 86,400 pennies into your account every morning. That's $864 a day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. So let's figure that out, he adds. But there's one stipulation, the banker says. You must spend all that money that same day. No balance will be carried forward or will be carried over to the next day. Each evening, the bank must cancel whatever sum you failed to use. This is your stipulation. With a big smile on your face, all of a sudden you thank the banker and you hang up. Now, over this weekend, you've had some time to plan. You grab your pencil and you start figuring up $864 times 7 equals over $6,000 a week. Times 52 weeks in a year, that's almost $315,000 that you have available if you're diligent to spend it all each day. Now remember, whatever you don't spend is forfeited. It's given up. All right, let's pretend, okay? Let's talk for real now. Let's get serious. Every morning, someone who loves you very much deposits into your bank of time 86,400 seconds of time, which represents 1,440 minutes, which of course equals 24 hours each day. Now, you've got to remember the same stipulation applies. Because God gives you this amount of time for you to use each day. Nothing is ever carried over on credit or the next day. There is no such thing as a 26-hour day, though some of us in this room wish there was. Some of us that work 24-hour periods says, no! From today's dawn, you have a precisely determined amount of time. And that's it. As someone has put it, life is like a coin. You can spend it in any way you want to, but you can spend it only once. Today, you've been given 86,400 seconds. 1,440 minutes. 24 hours. How much of it will you use for God? Oh, today's easy, Brother Keith. I'll be at church. I mean, I'm going to give God 2 hours in my morning and an hour in the afternoon. So I've met my tithe for the day. What's a tithe? The tenth? The tenth is two. So a tithe of 24 hours is 2.4 hours. So I've given God, I've gone above and beyond today, Brother Keith. I will have given him, if I just stay for Sunday school and church, and I come for church tonight, I will have given him 3 hours. But what about tomorrow? Now, some of you are going, I even come for choir practice. So I'm 4 hours. What about tomorrow? What about Tuesday? What about Wednesday? Oh, Wednesday, good. I'm glad you brought that up, Brother Keith, because, you know, I got church Wednesday night. And I guess I could count driving to and from, couldn't I? You know, because I get stuck in traffic. I'm going to church, right? Brother Ron's sitting down here figuring, Ms. Shriveman, they're figuring their extra hours they get on the road. They're like, ha ha, oh, I got this lit. Takes me an hour to get to church. So let's add that to my, man, I'm at 5 hours today. You're only given a certain amount of time. My question to you, are you seeking the Lord by tithing your time to Him? Giving back to Him what He's given you to use? We talk about being good stewards of the money He's given us. Yet we don't even contemplate the fact that He gives us time. What time are you giving Him? Well, can I tell you, in taking it seriously, it's time to act now. Because honestly, if we're all honest with ourselves, we can look back on our life and we've not given God much time. We've not given Him much of our time. In fact, many of us have lived lives that we're ashamed to really just talk about. We'd rather not because it's under the blood. Praise the Lord. But when we look back and we look at that time wasted, it's time for us to recognize it's time to act now on giving God what He deserves in our time. In fact, the Bible tells us it's time to act now several ways. In Romans chapter 13, it says this in verse 11, "And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep." It's time to get up. It's time to open your eyes and say, "Hello, good morning." All throughout the book of Proverbs, it talks about the slumbering man. He just, instead of getting up, he just rolls over again. There's been a couple of mornings I've wanted to do that. Hit the snooze and roll over, right? Hit the snooze again and roll over, right? I know some of you, you work worse hours than I could even imagine. And I know that feeling is there. Christian, it's time. Listen, we have been slumbering Christians for too long. We've hit the snooze button for way too long. How do we hit the snooze button? We come up with excuses why not to do something for God today. We come up with reasons why I shouldn't go do that today. Or I can't do that today. For now is our salvation nearer than we believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. It's time to awake out of sleep. It's time to open our eyes, church. It's time for ourselves to get real with ourselves. It's time for us to act on what we know to be right. Act on what we know to be truth. Act on what is right in front of our face. Because time is fleeting. Time's almost gone. Your time, you can't plan on tomorrow. Because tomorrow may never come. But unfortunately, we live like we have many tomorrows. Ephesians chapter 5 says, "See then that ye walk circumspectly." Walk looking around. Don't walk with your head in the sand. Don't walk looking down all the time. But look, pay attention. Yesterday, I was walking with Ellie, one of my middle daughters, and we were soul winning, and we were talking about paying attention as we walk and as we talk. I was teaching her how when I'm walking down the street with her, I want her to walk on the inside next to the curb. Let me walk on the outside. And any young man in her future better do the same thing. Young men in this room, you're ever walking down the side of a street with a young lady, even if you're on the sidewalk, you better walk on the outside and let her walk on the inside. Can I get an amen, gentlemen? I was talking about that. We're talking about taking care, guarding. But I was talking about making sure we walk around, and as we're talking, that we pay attention to other things going on. Because you never know what you might walk into. We were walking down a driveway, and we were getting close to the end of the driveway, and she was talking to me, and I was talking back. And she was looking down and looking at me and looking down and looking at me. And we're still talking, and I said, "Zip, stop." And she kind of looked at me like, "Why?" Big old truck with trailer come by. I said, "You've always got to be paying attention, even when you're talking, even when you're walking." Christian, we put our heads in the sand. Christian, we've overslept many times. Christian, God's word says we need to awake out of sleep. And then here he's going to say in verse 16, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Buying back the time. What time? The time we've wasted. We know it's valuable. We know we can't get it back. Well, it's time to buy back. It's time to get back what time we can by using what time God has given to us left to our best ability. Giving God His deserves. That wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Colossians chapter 4, verse 5 says, "Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time." You know, I've talked to many who are given a timeline as to when an illness was going to take their life. It's amazing with how much gusto they live those remaining days. It's amazing how they try to do everything that they've ever wanted to do. And I mean everything. They've got and there's an old movie called The Bucket List. I'm not referring to the movie, but I wanted to use that term. They've got a list of things they want to do before they kick the bucket. Fly a plane, scale a mountain, drive this kind of car. And they got this list. Our problem is we're so focused on those physical, tangible things of what we want, we miss what God wants. And we miss the one who gave us the time to begin with. We miss the fact that we've robbed God of the time He gave us. It's His time. So we've looked at a couple of things this morning. We have simply, we've had some fun, but we've talked about our time being limited. We've talked about the fact that we don't understand, we don't know our time. It's very limited. We've talked about the fact that our time is valuable. We've talked about the fact that we need to act on what we know to be true right now. The time to act is now, not to say, to put snooze on again. Don't hit snooze again this morning and say, Brother Keith, that was a great message, but I got plans this week. My week's already planned out. My schedule's full. So I want to make some application this morning. And this is what I want to challenge you with. First off, I want you to look back on this past week. Look back on it. In your mind's eyes, I want you to think back on this past week. And ask and tell me, better yet, tell yourself what you've truly done for the Lord this month, this week. Just this week. What have you done? And then this is what I want to challenge you with in this application. Number one, the psalmist says, number our days. He says, so teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. This gives the mindset of taking careful count, taking careful admonition, taking careful understanding of the days that I'm given. So teach me to number my days, to recognize, to count them, to pay attention to them, to recognize they're a gift from God. I didn't give you today. You didn't give you today. Only God did. My days are in thy hands. Our application needs to be this. Lord, my day is important. You've given it to me. Teach me to pay attention to it and to use it properly. Teach me to use my day and apply it unto wisdom. Well, what is true wisdom? God. His word. Number our days. You can look back and you can say, well, I am 41 years old. So that means I've been given 41 times 365. Anybody do that in their head? Not me. Been given a lot of days. I get that I'm not promised anymore. You already have an answer back there? somebody's spouting off numbers. But have you ever thought about that? That's 14,965 days. Were you right? 14,965 days that I have been on this earth. So let's just talk about it for a minute. If I was right with God and tithing to God my time, how many days should belong to Him? 149? Is that right? 10%? I can't do math in my head. Do what? 1,400 days? Well, almost 1,500 days. How many days do you think I've done given Him? How many days do you think you've given Him? So teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Can I challenge you with this? Application, number one, number our days. Number two, I'm going to strive to give the rest to the Lord. I'm going to make sure I give my days to Him first. Oh, I've got a calendar book on my desk. I do. And it's filled with a lot of appointments. A lot of things that I hope to do. But the first thing on my schedule ought not to be what I want to do. It ought to be what God wants me to do. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 is a verse that we often read and we fly through it because we've quoted it many times. I beseech ye therefore, brethren. Who's he talking to? Brethren, Church of Rome. Who's he talking to? Christians. I beseech ye therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. He's not asking for above and beyond. He's not asking for what you don't have. He's simply asking you to give Him what you do have. And that's just reasonable because of all that He did for us. All that He gave to us. And yet we have a hard time giving Him 10 minutes in the morning to read our Bible. We have a hard time giving Him 5 minutes in prayer during the day. We have a hard time focusing on Him while we're in the church service because our minds are wandering. And as we get closer to 12 o'clock, our stomach starts interfering too. Grumbling and rumbling and everything else. Can I challenge you today? Don't rob God of your tithe of time. May we do our reasonable service and give our time to the Lord and let Him tell us what we're supposed to do with it. Father, my time is in your hands, the psalmist says. My days are in your hand. My time is in your hand, Lord. And I've got plans. I know I've laid out plans for my life. But God, you deserve my time. So it doesn't matter what I've planned. Doesn't matter what I've laid out. God, I want to do it what you want me to do. My time is yours. I pray that'd be your prayer today. And God, I want to use the time you give me to do what you want me to do. So therefore, God, I humbly submit myself to your timetable, your will in my life. Today, Lord, I give my time to you. And Lord, I'm going to start with a tithe of my time. Lord, you only give me 24 hours in a day, and I want to give you at least a tenth of that. But Brother Keith, that doesn't fit in my schedule. That doesn't fit in my calendar. No. Then you better clear your calendar and start over. Because it's not your calendar. Those aren't your days. It's not your time. It's His. Would you give Him your time today? Every head bowed and our eye closed this morning. Our instrumentalists, our musicians are moving. Time is passing right now. In this, since you've been sitting in this room this morning, you've already lost an hour. You have. You did give it to the Lord by being in church. I agree with that. But it's an hour of time you'll never get back. There's no way to carry it over, make it up. And can I tell you, you probably did one of the most important things you could ever do on a Sunday morning by giving God your time. But Christian, Sunday's an easy day. Give Him your Monday. Give Him your Tuesday. Give Him your Wednesday. Give Him your Thursday. Give Him your Friday. And give Him your Saturday. They all belong to Him anyways. Would you give them back to Him? This morning you may not know the Lord as your Savior, and you're not promised tomorrow. We've been talking about time all day. You're not promised tomorrow. Something could happen today and you could lose your life. My question to you is this: do you know where you will spend eternity? Do you know that you'll spend eternity in a place called heaven? If you don't, the Bible is very clear how you can know for sure your sins are forgiven, that you'll spend eternity in heaven. And this morning, we'd love to take the opportunity to show you this morning, to take God's Word and clearly show you, written in His love letter to us in the Word of God, how you can know your sins are forgiven. That question won't bother you anymore. Christian, who's managed your time? Who owns your time? Who has your time today? If we were honest, we'd say, I've run my time, I've done my time, I've controlled my time, and God's got very little of it. But today, I am determined, my decision is clear. Lord, my time is in Your hands, and I give it back to You. Use me and the time You've given me for Your will. Would you make that decision today with every head bowed and every eye closed? Let's stand to our feet for a time of invitation. The piano is going to begin to play. Brother Ron's begin to sing. Would you take a moment? Just make that decision today. Come to this altar and say, Lord, I'm making this decision in my heart. I'm making it publicly to You by coming to this altar and saying, Lord, I'm going to give You my time. I've stolen too much of the time You've given me, Lord. I've taken it. I've used it for my own stuff, for my own glory. God, today I'm giving You my time back. God, I want You to have all of me. I want to live for You. I want to do Your will. God, I want to give You my time. God, that means I'm going to have to look at my schedule again, but God, I want to do it. Do you know the Lord is your Savior? Time is of the essence.